Calorama, a Recorded Books hybrid imprint, presents We the Possibility, Harnessing Public Entrepreneurship to Solve Our Most Urgent Problems, by Mitchell Weiss. Read by Tom Perkins. Publishers note, this audiobook has bonus material of visual elements supporting the text. Please contact whomever you purchase this audiobook from to request the material. Introduction. Can we solve public problems anymore? Their tears told me something my emergency notifications hadn't yet. People were streaming from the direction of Boylston Street as I stepped outside my apartment. I lived close to 500 yards from the blasts, but hadn't heard them. Stopped by police officers at first, I snaked my way toward and then into the medical tent. Everything seemed strangely organized, except that I do remember a handwritten sign off to the left, morgue. In a few minutes, I would myself be on Boylston Street talking to the mayor on the phone. "You are my eyes and ears," he would say, but I already knew that when I looked in. The makeshift morgue was empty, but three people had lost their lives along the race route. More than 200, we'd later learn, had been wounded by shrapnel from the pressure cooker bombs that two terrorists had detonated at the finish line on Boston's best day of the year. Immediately following the blasts, the rush was on to save their lives, to track down the perpetrators, and to put a wrecked city back together. I would have nothing to do with the first two tasks, but would play some role in the third, and doing so left me with the questions I've spent all the years since investigating. Can we solve public problems anymore? Can we do new things? The new thing we intended to do in 2013 was stand up a new fund to channel money from generous people everywhere to the families of the victims and to the survivors. Traditional methods of dispersing donations in the wake of attacks like this were plodding. 8 months had passed since 20 children and 6 adults were killed at Sandy Hook Elementary School, and I'd heard that not a penny had made it to the families of those who died there nor those injured. Now, Boston's survivors would have life-changing decisions to make about limbs, homes, and jobs, and they couldn't wait for relief. If we started up a new organization instead of going with a trusted and long-established institution in town, we had a fighting chance of getting relief to them quickly enough. The head of Boston's century-old community foundation did not see things the same way. The morning after the bombs went off, as I stood inside Brigham and Women's Hospital, where the mayor would later visit survivors being treated there, the foundation chief was berating me over the phone. "You'll raise less money," he insisted. "You can't start something new." We rejected those objections, started One Fund Boston with a PayPal account that night and a post office box the next morning, and raced to collect and distribute as much money as possible before July 4th, Independence Day. A year after the marathon attacks, two survivors asked me to tell them how One Fund Boston had come to be, and then urged me to tell that story to others. You have to show people that government can do new things. Which is it, really, most of the time? Is it what the foundation head or the survivors had said? Can governments start new things? Need public officials be so afraid to try new solutions? Or can we do something, all of us, the public, and the people we put in office, to change that? Turning toward something else. 5 years after the marathon attacks, even though the question, can we solve public problems anymore, was on my mind for most of that time, I finally set out to write this book. I saw so many reasons why we needed new ideas about government doing new things. There was a long list of vexing problems: hunger, poverty, climate change, extreme inequality, crumbling infrastructure. There was the breakdown in faith between people and national governments that this pileup of problems had created. In 2015, less than half of the people in Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, member countries were found to have trust in theirs. There were threats from competitors or adversaries who might race ahead, and some threats were existential. Russia's Vladimir Putin, for instance, has said that whichever nation leads in artificial intelligence will become the ruler of the world. A talent crisis loomed in the public sector as the retirement of baby boomers from such jobs was called a silver tsunami. Many younger adults, 64% of American millennials and 70% of Generation Z, said they wanted government to do more to solve public problems. But how? Several entrepreneurs were about to leap into the U.S. presidential campaign. The number of startups entering into public entrepreneurship was growing almost every day. The Facebook hearings in the spring of 2018, which I had come to see as a sort of Rorschach test, exposed a tech-government divide that needed to be bridged. Techies who had watched Senator Orrin Hatch question Mark Zuckerberg on how it was that Facebook made money if it didn't charge customers, "Senator, we run ads," grumbled at government's ignorance of technology. But policy types who had watched Zuckerberg wondered how he could have set out to create a new civic square while knowing so little about government. All these reasons, the pileup of problems, the public's lack of trust that its leaders can and will address them, the stepping in and, sometimes stepping in it, of the entrepreneurs and the techie types would justify setting out to describe a new way forward. But they weren't my reasons. Nor did I decide to write the book when one mayor I was with said, "I feel like the weight of the world is now on our shoulders," even though that feeling was common to many of us. Ultimately, what motivated me to write the book was the sense that all over the world people were turning on each other, and that we should try to get them to turn together toward something else instead. Possibility government. Can we solve public problems anymore? Yes, if we'll need to move on from what I've come to call probability government. That's the kind of government that does mostly what's pretty sure to work but leads often to middling mediocre outcomes. We'll need to move toward possibility government instead. That's the kind of government that pursues efforts that only might work, which means they probably won't work. Possibility is the realm of the entrepreneur. More than 70% of new ventures fail, but a few that succeed transform our lives and our society, ideally for the good. Possibility government is new and not new. Ever since we've had government, we've had people inventing it. Upon hearing of this book's subject, a friend of mine teased, "Wasn't it Socrates or Aristotle who did that?" Every type of government was invented at some point before or after the ancient Greeks, and every apparatus of government, money and central banks, post offices, patent offices, was too. Every policy has at one point been imagined and tried, likely at more than one point. Policies to enhance workplace safety and to improve the quality of the water in the air. Policies aimed at training people for new jobs or taking them into space. Taxation of every sort has been tried and retried. Regressive and progressive taxes, federal, state, and local taxes, stamp taxes, and sin taxes. And so have all of those things taxes pay for: highways and their maintenance, public education, the social safety net, and every branch of the military and all of the equipment anyone serving in those branches has ever used. Possibility has been a part of government as long as there's been government, but so has the pushback to it. This tug of war between the two has been enshrined in forms of government. The creation of a two-chamber U.S. Congress was an exercise in balancing power among larger states and smaller ones, but it was also an exercise in balancing the future and the past, of what's been and what might be. The U.S. Constitution made sure that the government of the young country would tend in both directions. Even the word Constitution expresses this duality. It derives from the Latin constitutio, meaning act of settling, settled condition, order, and also constituere, to set up, establish, form something new. Over time, the new has been too snuffed out in favor of the settled. This has been a matter of political philosophy and politics, of dominant strains in public management practice and education, and it's been a matter of existence. The famed management guru Peter Drucker once wrote, "In the existing business, it is the existing that is the main obstacle to entrepreneurship. In the new venture, it is its absence." The founders of our nations, our towns, our agencies had to create something from nothing, which is difficult. We have to create something else from something, which is proving to be difficult, too. Eleanor Ostrom was not the first person to suggest that the new giving way to the settled in government might only be temporary, and that with novel forms of action and leadership we might provide new public goods and services again. But she was the first, I believe, to coin the phrase public entrepreneurship. In her 1965 PhD dissertation about groundwater basin management in California, she wrote, "The existence of entrepreneurship in the private sector raises the question of whether there is a comparable function performed by those who undertake to provide public goods and services in the public sector, which might appropriately be characterized as public entrepreneurship." Nearly 45 years later, Ostrom would win the Nobel Prize in Economics, but not primarily for her work on public entrepreneurship. She mentions it just once in her prize lecture, and it never became a household phrase. It might have. In 1993, David Osborne and Ted Gabler, a journalist and a former city manager respectively, laid out a strong case for public entrepreneurship. In Reinventing Government: How the Entrepreneurial Spirit is Transforming the Public Sector, they wrote, "Our governments are in deep trouble today. This book is for those who are disturbed by that reality. It is for the seekers. If ever there was a time for seekers, this is it." The revolution they had hoped to prime never came to pass in full. We the Possibility. Politics has long had a language of possibility, though the rhetoric has often exceeded the reality. When a former U.S. president said, "While I take inspiration from the past, like most Americans, I live for the future. I hope you will let me talk about a country that is forever young," he was uttering sentiments that could have come from almost any president in the country's history. It was Ronald Reagan in 1992, but it could have been Barack Obama in 2014. We choose hope over fear. We see the future not as something out of our control, but as something we can shape for the better through concerted and collective effort. It could have been Robert Kennedy or Franklin Roosevelt. It could have been Angela Merkel. The question is not whether we are able to change, but whether we are changing fast enough. Or Jacinda Ardern, "This stardust won't settle because none of us should settle." It could have been the Mexico City mayor we'll meet in Chapter 3, or any of hundreds of other mayors delivering a State of the City address, or local committee chairs championing a new transportation plan, or school principals launching school turnarounds. Summoning the future is a time-honored endeavor. Occasioning it is tougher stuff. We talk about ushering in the future, but in practice, we don't really know how. Many people would deem public entrepreneurship, aka possibility government, crazy. One of my favorite books on entrepreneurship starts, "If you tell people that you want to become an entrepreneur, they'll tell you you are crazy. And the trouble is, they might be right." They might be right. How would you know? How could you possibly tell the difference? Maybe you have spotted a huge business opportunity and have come up with a world-changing solution to it. Or maybe you are just another deluded dreamer who is about to make the biggest mistake of your life. How would you know? After all, if you are the deluded dreamer, you are the last person in the world you ought to listen to. Who and what should you believe? And why? It's all going to come down to how carefully and precisely you think about this. If we are not deluded dreamers, if public entrepreneurship is not the oxymoron everyone makes it out to be, we'll have to carefully and precisely think about and engage in its pursuit. In particular, we'll need to achieve three things. We'll need new ideas. So, chapters 1 and 2, problems as opportunities, and reach out to reach up, look at the challenge of building government that can imagine. We are swimming in policy proposals, but are still short of fresh thinking. And the reason is that our creativity is too limited by the resources at hand, our funding, our people, our assets. These chapters cover how to be opportunity-driven rather than resource-driven, and how to look outside of our organizations, to the crowd, and especially to the people we serve, for new solutions. We'll meet a man in charge of equipping the U.S. Special Forces and follow his effort to make sure the Navy SEALs, Army Rangers, and other special operators get access to the newest ideas, and that the newest ideas, including a hoverboard and the Frenchman flying on it, get access to them. We'll acquaint ourselves with a Cincinnati resident who returns to her hometown to help solve its opioid epidemic with a weekend-long hackathon, so that we can uncover how best to reach out to outsiders who might produce new ideas we can actually make use of. We'll meet a former Facebook product manager while he is waiting in line for food stamps. He left to start his own company that would help serve low-income Americans, and his experience can help us learn what lengths we need to go to with our users to see how they experience government and to harness their insights for our new solutions. If we can successfully come up with new ideas, we'll need ways to try them. We'll need to build governments that can take on riskier projects. Chapters 3 and 4, Experimenting in Public and Regulating the Future, look at techniques for building government that can try new things. The head of Mexico City's innovation office says, "A thousand things could have gone wrong," when she and her team set out to crowdsource a map of the city's 30,000 buses, minibuses, and vans. And we'll watch her proceed anyway in a series of short experiments so that we can pick up the build, measure, learn techniques of lean startups and see how they can be applied in public and when they should be. The mayor of Pittsburgh reasons that he has to be both a pragmatist and a politician, and we'll observe him try to balance the two roles as he welcomes autonomous cars to his city's streets. We'll follow him through the aftermath of a fatality involving a self-driving car on the other side of the country, so we can see how to persevere with build, measure, learn techniques even when the thing you are building might be dangerous. We'll meet the head of global partnerships for Airbnb and her innovation counterparts in Amsterdam's city government as new home sharing options emerge in a famously permissive city to considerable pushback. We'll examine the partnership they craft for trying out this sort of thing so that we might use some of those tools for trying out whatever is coming next. If we can imagine new ideas, and if we can try them, we'll need to be able to scale the successful ones. It's essential to the logic of the entire possibility enterprise, that is, that a handful of huge successes will more than cover for the many failures. Chapters 5 and 6, Government as a Platform, and Tri-Sector Entrepreneurs, cover government that can scale. We find leaders at Weiss in the middle of their effort to take a data-sharing partnership to every city in the world, so that we can see how platform thinking is the toolkit behind that kind of ambition. It allows us to imagine what we could achieve with government as a platform if we thought in a similar way. We'll see how the man once described as India's Bill Gates uses that kind of thinking to provide identity and enable opportunity at what he calls population scale, in a country where population scale means more than a billion people. We'll also see how Amazon is building platforms as government and where, in the interest of equity, privacy, and democracy, we should draw the limits. We'll see that entrepreneurial leaders who navigate winding careers in the public, private, and not-for-profit sectors will be essential for sustaining possibility over time. We'll meet some who've done that, so that you might pick up tips for crafting such a career, and also so that we might consider whether we should welcome a rush of private entrepreneurs into public office and by what criteria we might judge them. While the first six chapters focus mostly on what possibility government is, Chapter 7, Inventing Democracy, focuses on what it could be for. Of all the things to turn our newfound entrepreneurial skills and tactics to, protecting and enhancing democracy in the United States and around the world is urgently important. So we'll sit on pins and needles as Uber's former lobbyist, a cybersecurity specialist turned entrepreneur, and West Virginia's Secretary of State pilot mobile voting, and we'll meet several other democracy entrepreneurs to evaluate how far we can go in deploying possibilities, techniques, and tools. About the mobile voting experiment, one person tweeted afterward, "Bonkers, America!" But which is more bonkers in light of a fraying democracy? To do something or to do nothing? What's more bonkers in light of fraying everything? As the book comes to a close, we consider the critiques of possibility government. Maybe this is all deluded dreaming? And we check in on one more episode of it, on Jason Bay and his team at GovTech Singapore and their 8-week pursuit amidst a global pandemic to deploy the first nationwide Bluetooth-enabled COVID-19 tracing app, so that we might test ourselves on whether we'd know the difference. Possibility in our time. If ever there were a time for seekers, this is it. I first purchased Osborne and Gabler's book while I was in college in the late 1990s, and the idea that you could combine entrepreneurial skills and government hit me like a lightning bolt. I had wanted to be in public service all my life. As a 9-year-old, I had sketched out campaign signs that read, "I will lead your nation like my mom leads me." I'd dressed up as a voting booth for Halloween, but I'd also always wanted to build stuff and start things. I'd dabbled in computer science in college, but majored in economics. When the two authors wrote that they hoped their roadmap would empower you to reinvent your governments, I really believed they meant me. And while I was alight with their suggestions, so were many others. The book's ideas had inspired President Clinton to announce a 6-month review of the U.S. federal government to be led by Vice President Al Gore. Clinton and Gore, two sunny leaders, were photographed grinning ear to ear and cutting actual red tape on the sunny White House lawn. "The Reinventing Government movement now holds the attention of the nation," wrote one scholar in 1998. Clinton had also said in launching the effort that it was past time for the government to adjust to an economy that was increasingly information-based. By 1996, there would be 10 million computers connected to the Internet, when half a decade earlier, that number had been less than 500,000. In 1993, Mosaic, the first graphical web browser, had been released, followed by Netscape Navigator the next year. Yahoo was founded to help people find things on the Internet, and then Google arrived to make search even easier. Clinton and Gore launched the first official White House website in 1994. The nascent European Union was encouraging e-government at the supranational level, as were its member countries and so many other administrative entities. If governments were going to become more entrepreneurial, that entrepreneurship, by dint of opportunity and timing, was going to be tied in with the speedy march of digital technology. I took my first full-time job in government in 2004. For a year and a half, I sat just outside Boston Mayor Thomas Menino's office, serving as an advisor. My first assignment had me transporting leftover computers from the Democratic National Convention in the back of a truck we had borrowed from Animal Control. That was the convention in Boston at which an Illinois state senator named Barack Obama referenced his parents' abiding faith in the possibilities of this nation. The PCs eventually made their way to new computing centers in senior housing. Trailing the mayor out of one such center after a ribbon-cutting ceremony, I saw residents already using the computers to look for adult material. These were the same computers the mayor had just announced would enable grandparents to email their grandkids. It was not the last time I would see the unanticipated outcomes of government plus new plus technology. I would soon be awakened to both the public's and the press's role in making us leery when it came to innovation, too. The first new idea that was really my own in government was an embarrassingly simple one. we should let people sign up for email notifications about snow emergencies in Boston to alert them to move their cars. When Mayor Menino announced it, Boston Globe columnist Brian McGrory called it perhaps the most ridiculous idea to come out of a local agency in years. It was lampooned in a political cartoon, which the mayor then framed and gave to me with a note of encouragement. So, I was also alerted to the role that cover from the top could play in making innovation happen. I helped on more successful and more effective efforts as well, which is presumably why the mayor asked me to come back to City Hall after a 4-year hiatus to be his chief of staff. I'd left to be a social entrepreneur at a not-for-profit conceived by a business school professor of mine. I'd geeked out there a bit on the idea of open innovation after getting to know Yochai Benkler and reading his account of NASA's Clickworkers experiment, which sought to determine if public volunteers, each working for a few minutes here and there, can do some routine science analysis that would normally be done by a scientist or graduate student working for months on end. When the mayor asked if I'd rejoin his administration for his fifth term, I said yes, in part because I had a crazy thought that if we could try open innovation in Boston, we could change the city. And if we could change the city, maybe we could change the world. With two amazing public servants, Chris Osgood and Nigel Jacob, we founded the mayor's office of New Urban Mechanics, which became one of the first big city innovation offices in the country, one infused with the idea that the key to public entrepreneurship was citizen participation. We had at our fingertips, as did public leaders all over the world, incredible new tools. Wikipedia had arrived in 2001, and if you could crowdsource an encyclopedia, it seemed at the moment like you could crowdsource almost anything. LinkedIn, Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter all arrived in quick succession, and so in 2006 it seemed to make perfect sense that Time magazine named you its Person of the Year, honoring all the individual content creators. The forefront of digital government those days was open government. Data.gov, the U.S. government data website, was launched in May 2009 on the heels of President Obama's Memorandum on Transparency and Open Government. The memorandum had been issued on Obama's inauguration day with recommendations for making the federal government more transparent, more participatory, and more collaborative. Both the iPhone and Android's releases in 2007 meant that participation had also gone mobile. Mayor Mike Bloomberg's administration launched New York's first NYC Big Apps competition to ask the public to marry up the raw city data that was now available in city-specific applications and make it available for smartphones and the web. Startups encouraged residents to use their phones to make their concerns known to their leaders. Fix My Street was launched in the United Kingdom to allow residents to tell their local leaders about potholes, broken streetlights, and such. A community member in New Haven, Connecticut, frustrated with his government's lack of responsiveness, started a company called See Click Fix in 2008 to allow residents to do the same. In 2015, a report of graffiti on the side of a public building became the 2 millionth issue that the company had collected and directed to a city agency. I'd cold emailed Apple's CEO Steve Jobs on a Thursday in November 2010 to tell him Boston's mayor was launching the second version of our own citizen reporting app 4 days later, and that we were having trouble getting it approved for the company's app store. By Monday, lo and behold, we were ready to go. Jen Palka wondered at TED whether government could be run like the Internet, permissionless and open, and started Code for America to recruit a generation of talent into government that could make it so. In 2014, I returned to Harvard Business School to join the faculty. The school's dean had chatted with me after an event. He and I knew each other somewhat, and he asked if I was going to run to succeed my boss. Mayor Menino had announced in March 2013 that he would not run for a sixth term in office. I laughed at the prospect, and the dean asked what I was planning to do. Eventually, I sat in his office and told him this. I've seen so much opportunity from entrepreneurship in government, but I've also seen how difficult it is, And I think one reason it is difficult is that we are training people wrong. At policy schools, we tell people who want to go work in government to be analysts and strategists, and not inventors and builders. And while government needs analysts and strategists, it needs inventors and builders too. And at business schools like Harvard's, we have people who want to be inventors and builders, but we don't teach them that they can invent and build in government or for government. He replied, "Come do that here." So I came back to the school and created a course on public entrepreneurship in 2015, I think the first of its kind at any business school in the country. The course is built around the same question as this book. Can we solve public problems anymore? The question has taken me around the world to look for answers. I begged my way into a data center in Tbilisi, Georgia, where they were mining for bitcoins, but also helping the government there try to protect property rights using the blockchain. I've listened in on gunfire detected on America's city streets by sensors that sorted the sound from fireworks using algorithms in the cloud. I interviewed the former health minister of Rwanda, Dr. Agnes Binagwaho, who told me, "Of course I'm a public entrepreneur," and who insisted there was nothing very adventurous about Rwanda's effort to use drones to deliver blood and anti-venom. But I've also heard from dozens of people who told me that none of this, the course, the book, the very idea of possibility government, would ever work. I went to Amsterdam, where an official told me, "Please don't take offense, but we don't trust U.S. tech companies very much." I was in Beijing to understand the rise of one of China's bike share behemoths. While there, I got to see SenseTime, the world's largest AI startup and one of the world's most controversial for its surveillance capabilities. And no doubt while I was there, SenseTime got to see me. Although I had landed back to teach where I had gone to school nearly 3 decades before, the world had changed utterly. There were now 4 times more connected devices on the planet than there were people, and some of them were artificially intelligent. Booming startup cultures had spread way beyond Silicon Valley, although not equally across countries or within them, and those divides had helped fuel frustrations that were boiling over. The cloud had given millions the chance to start things on the cheap, and millions had. Floods of venture capital had given those millions billions, but now society was awakening to a fear that hypergrowth had concentrated power and risk. A wave of tech had swept over us, but then after it exposed our privacy and made vulnerable our democracy and threatened our jobs, a distrust of big tech, the so-called techlash, ensued. Tech for good was one response to the backlash, promising to turn technological advances toward things like cleaner water and more affordable housing and longer lives. But that, too, seemed vulnerable to a bubbling hashtag tech for good lash. Millennials, and not just millennials, weren't sure they wanted their companies getting in bed with their governments on some issues, or getting involved with them at all. When I was in college, 2020 seemed like a distant science fiction future. But now that we had arrived, I had to wonder, was there any prudent way for government to collaborate with technologists and entrepreneurs that didn't make one or the other a villain? Could we together solve public problems anymore? If I were going into government now, if I were working in a town hall or a federal building, on an army base or in a classroom, I'd want a book like this on my desk, one that told me what I knew deep down but that might have been worn out of me, that government can still help solve public problems. And I'd want a book that showed me how to try the things that I'd thought of and how to persevere with new stuff even in the face of risk. I'd also want to know how to think about the endless new technologies being offered to or sometimes foisted on government and how to respond. If I thought about running for office, I'd want a book that made me braver, that gave me the tools to try what I had actually run for office meaning to do. I'd think about all that had changed over the last 30 years, and I'd want a book that helped me think about how to handle what was coming next. Several years ago, I was invited to speak on public entrepreneurship at 10 Downing Street in London. I finished my talk by noting that of all the new government services we could invent with startup methods, perhaps the most important thing we could do was show a new generation who had grown up on those techniques that they could go into government and make a difference with them. If I were young again, I'd definitely want a book that showed me that. And since I'm none of those things, not young, and not running for office, and not working for those who are, I'd want a book that told me how to regard those who were. I'd want to know how to vote in an age of uncertainty. I'd want to know how much experimentation I should tolerate by our public leaders and how much I should encourage. I'd want skills for sniffing out leaders who would truly solve problems as opposed to those who would merely talk of doing so. I'd want to learn how I could participate in an entrepreneurial movement and how I could make sure others could too. This is the book I've tried to write. Mater artium necessitas? Necessity is the mother of invention, we've been told. If this is true, it never appeared more so than when COVID-19 ravaged the world in 2020. Leaders everywhere, but especially in the public sector, were made instant entrepreneurs. They invented new policies to keep people safe and new programs to supply and support them. And if this is false, if necessity is instead and too often the mother of obfuscation and evasion, it was never more so than in the days and years leading up to this pandemic, and even during it. Leaders in some places did nothing when they could have tried something. Never let a good crisis go to waste, we have heard, but we often fail to reckon that crises are here with us all the time, and we neglect to anticipate the wreckage that will be wrought while we wait. Waiting to change was once again revealed as an empty strategy in the summer of 2020, since waiting in the United States had meant yet more black women and men had to die at the hands of their governments. Mayor Melvin Carter, who we meet in Chapter 2, and whose St. Paul, Minnesota office was a 20-minute drive from where a Minneapolis police officer spent more than 8 fatal minutes with his knee on George Floyd's neck, told me, "Patience is for the privileged." 5 decades earlier, Martin Luther King Jr. had called time one of 2 or 3 myths that still pervade our nation. He'd said of persistent racial injustice, "They've said, if you'll just be nice and patient and continue to pray, in 100 or 200 years, the problem will work itself out." There is an answer to that myth. It is that time is neutral. It can be used either constructively or destructively, and so we must always help time and realize the time is always right to do right. Necessity is the mother of invention, or is it not? We can still solve public problems, or can we not? A prior crisis had set me on a search for answers. As I finished that search, 2 present crises demanded answers. The one I'd already drafted into this book, Possibility Government, is an incomplete remedy to them all, but it is the best I have. We can help time. We get the government we invent. We can solve public problems if. We can solve public problems if we move toward possibility. The entrepreneurial spirit can still transform the public sector, even though entrepreneurship is under scrutiny, as it should be, even though much is broken in our civics and beyond. We are not yet too far gone. Possibility government hasn't quite been pulled off, but now it is our turn to try. Part 1. Government That Can Imagine. 1. Problems as opportunities. The ratio was telling. Just 1 safety check to 2 camera checks. It was spring 2016, and Frankie Zapata was about to try a 4-minute trip on the flying hoverboard he had built. It would dart thousands of feet above the ground at 55 kilometers per hour. 4 engines, each with 250 horsepower, would give him flight, and Zapata wanted to be sure the cameras were ready. His team at Zapata Racing would later post the video to YouTube. They'd better get some good footage. Beyond that, Zapata, a former champion jet ski racer turned entrepreneur, had not much of a plan. You know, when you decide to have a child, you decide to have a child because you want it. You don't decide to have a child because it will become a surgeon or a lawyer, he later explained by way of analogy to a reporter. It's possible Zapata's child was about to follow a decidedly different career path. A commander within one of the classified programs at the U.S. Special Operations Command saw the clip on YouTube not long after. He forwarded it to James Gertz and Tamreen Bates along with the text, "Why aren't we doing this?" Gertz was in charge of equipping, training, and supplying the nation's most elite warfighters, the Navy SEALs, the Army Special Forces, the Air Force Air Commandos. Bates was a former special operator himself. He had been deployed all over the globe, Somalia, South America, the Balkans, Afghanistan, and Iraq. He ran an outpost of the Special Operations Command called Softworks that Gertz had set up in a former tattoo parlor to be best in class in the future. And the two now found themselves intrigued by a 121-second video of a French thrill-seeker on his flying board. Gertz wasn't sure the flyboard was real. Bates found the music kind of campy, but he cold-called Zapata Racing anyway. "I told them who we were and said I would love him to come talk to us. If it's real, let's see what you can do with it." And with that, Zapata flew to Florida to meet with Gertz, Bates, other Softworks affiliates, and special operators, though without his flyboard because it couldn't get through French export restrictions. Reporters had wondered whether the flyboard was the coolest thing ever invented or a massive hoax. Gertz and crew were about to find out. After Gertz tipped me off to the video and I learned of his sincere interest in it, I wanted to uncover something else. Why? Why were Gertz and Bates and the commander who had sent them the link trolling for ideas on YouTube? The U.S. Department of Defense spends more than $600 billion a year. It employs more people than any other organization in the United States. Among them are the country's bravest and most ingenious. The Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, the DoD's research arm, is one of the most renowned in the world. Scientists there helped invent the Internet, developed GPS, and built the ancestor to cloud computing. On top of that, American defense firms spend billions on research and development every single year to invent new solutions to the nation's security challenges. So why was Gertz mining ideas for the most elite warfighters who get sent on the most dangerous missions in the same place you and I watch prank videos and clips of Colbert? In Chapter 2, we'll address more directly the virtues of looking for ideas among so-called non-experts. But I wanted to be sure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.